But listen to what's going to happen when God saves Israel. In verse 26, arriving out of Zion shall be the rescuer, and he will be turning irreverence from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them. This is the covenant, the same covenant God made with Abraham, except it's a new covenant because Abraham couldn't fulfill it. The whole nation couldn't fulfill it. God's going to fulfill it whenever I should be eliminating their sins. A, turning away your reverence from Jacob hasn't happened yet. B, eliminating their sins, well, for Israel, that hasn't happened yet either. But this salvation will come to Israel. But this is the born again. Would you say that, Dan? That this pretty much, if you look at Romans 28, arriving, this is the new birth right here.
This is their birth as a nation.
This is the new birth that our Lord was speaking of in John chapter 3 to Nicodemus. This is where it's fulfilled. Arriving out of Zion shall be the rescuer. And notice rescuer. He's not coming to congratulate him. He's coming to rescue him.
Isn't that interesting? Because some think, have an idea that the job of the mankind, whether the church or Israel, is to rescue the world from the wickedness.
Yeah, and rescue God or whatever.
Rescue God, fix up things yeah. So God can be, you know, a whole person again or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's a lot of stuff to handle. The red letters aren't for us.
The red letters aren't for us.
And God is going to restore Israel. I want to give you a little comparison here for those who.
Maybe we should put it this way.
Yeah.
And to avoid another bad night's sleep for me
okay,
tonight.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
Maybe we should say that the red letters aren't to us.
That's it. That's right.
We said four.
Well, the whole Bible
make
is four. Let me
should make a distinction.
I'm going to make a distinction right here. Let me fix it so I can sleep tonight. All the Bible is for us. The letters of Paul are to us and about us.
As contrasted with the letters in red, which are
to Israel
and about Israel.
But
for us in the sense that we read it,
sure.
Learn of God's
operations. As a matter of fact, the Gospel of Luke was written by Luke to Theophilus, who was a convert of Paul. It was written to teach Theophilus about what the Lord taught to Israel on earth.
And how many people, speaking of losing sleep now,
yes.
How many people have lost sleep by applying those red words to themselves?
Yes.
As far as cast off your hand, gouge out your eyes, better to do that than to end up in the Gehenna of fire. Give everything
right.
You own to the poor. Unless you confess your sins, God won't forgive you.
Yes.
You have a danger of committing the unpardonable sin. People have tortured themselves with these verses that are to Israel.
Yes.
And they belong to a different administration.
Well, let's just compare, and we say here on this program, we believe all the scriptures, all Hebrew and Greek scriptures. We believe that Paul's letters are to us and about us. I just want to compare the ministry of the 12 apostles. And by the way, why are there 12 apostles?
Because there are 12 tribes.
Ah,
12 is a magic number.
And the Lord Jesus,
with the kingdom.
And the Lord Jesus said, He chose the 12, and he says, you will sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel.
Israel. That's a big clue there.
Now,
Israel.
Now, let's compare the ministry of the 12 with Paul. And I'm just going to give you a couple comparisons. First of all, the 12 were called by the Lord Jesus when he was on earth, right?
Yes.
Paul was chosen by the risen Christ Jesus from glory. See the difference there? That's a big difference. The 12... spoke about Christ and were with Christ before his ascension. Paul, after the ascension of Christ. The 12 ministered in the land. Where did Paul minister?
Outside the land.
The 12 were for the circumcision. Paul for the uncircumcision. The 12's burden of their ministry was the earthly life of Christ before the ascension. And Paul begins with the Lord in glory. There's a difference.
Mm.
Difference of viewpoint. The 12 had a promise of an allotment on earth, and Paul's message was about an allotment among the celestials. Two completely different realms. Those are some comparisons.
Yeah, I mean, those are legitimate comparisons. Peter never had an expectation of going to heaven. He's the one that asked Christ, where will we be? What will
happen
to us?
Let's back that up. Nobody until Paul ever talked about going to heaven.
True.
King David didn't. And you know what? David's not in heaven now. In the book of Acts, it says that no man, David has not ascended up to heaven, Acts chapter 2.
Mm-hmm.
And in John chapter 3, no man has ascended up to heaven. There's nobody's there except the Lord Jesus and angels and so forth, different messengers. But nobody before Paul ever talked about or even thought about going to heaven. It was always an earthly hope. David, remember the book of Job? Job says, I will be satisfied. I will see my Redeemer on earth.
So when Peter raises from the dead,
yes.
Peter, James, John, and those other guys, that's yeah. Peter, James, John, that's three, there's nine left. Okay.
Yep.
Those 12 disciples raised from the dead, they're not going anywhere. They're going to be on the earth. I mean, when I say they're not going anywhere, they're not leaving the ground.
No,
they're
not
ascending to rise with Christ.
And I got scripture even, let's go back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The Lord Jesus says this. He says that many from the east and the west shall be arriving and reclining with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of the heavens. Yet the sons of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be lamenting and gnashing of teeth. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob will be resurrected and be part of this kingdom on earth. The kingdom of the heavens is not in heaven.
Say that again.
The kingdom of the heavens is not in heaven. It's in Jerusalem, in the promised land. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob will be resurrected there, and many Gentiles are going to come enjoy the privileges of that, and yet the Israelites who are unfaithful are going to be cast out of it. And they're going to be watching it from the outside. That's why they're going to be weeping and gnashing teeth.
Now, there's some people
because they missed out.
Right. There's some people who think this kingdom's never going to happen.
Yeah.
And you mentioned that earlier, that they do away with this idea or this fact of the kingdom because they spiritualize it. They make of the body of Christ spiritual Israel. They think that because I read that verse in Romans. When did I read that verse? Was that yesterday or today? I can't remember.
Romans 11?
Romans 11:25.
Yeah.
That God is still going to fulfill his promises to Israel. But people think that, well, since he didn't do that in the first century and that God has temporarily set Israel aside, that God's never going to take them back again. But if we read there in Romans, Paul says, if their casting away is the salvation of the world, I'll just read it instead of paraphrasing it, Romans 11:12, if their offense is the world's riches and their discomfiture the nation's riches, how much rather that which fills them? As to they are going to be filled, in verse 15, for if their casting away is the conciliation of the world, what will the taking back be? The taking back. God's going to take Israel back. The church today, the body of Christ, is not some kind of mystical, spiritual fulfillment of what God has promised Israel. God is going to take Israel back to himself, but it's not going to happen until, as Paul says in verse 25, 26, the complement of the nations may be entering. Then he's going to fulfill his plans
and
for
Israel. The ministry to the body of Christ is the only company, the only group of people that whose calling is not put on hold. In other words, it's this word taking back applies that they were cast aside at one time and will be taken back. Members of the body of Christ will never be cast aside. There will be no taking back. We're justified. We have all these blessings already in Christ.
Ladies and gentlemen, where is your expectation? What part of the scriptures is to you? What are you looking forward to? Are you taking verses that don't belong to you and applying them to yourself? Are you condemning yourself? Are you worried that you're not making the grade because if you don't confess your sins, Christ is not going to forgive your sins? Where are you in God's program? We are attempting to introduce you to the place where you are, and we don't want you to take other scriptures because you're going to get confused. The whole Bible is for you, but it's not all to you. Let's distinguish it. It's going to give you a peace like you've never known before.
Yeah, it's been a good 2 weeks, huh?
Yeah, sure has, Dan.
It's been a good 2 weeks. We appreciate y'all being with us. I'm Dan Sheridan, and you can find me at paulsevangel.com.
I'm Martin Zender. I'm at martinzender.com.
And you guys all have a great weekend. Think about what we're saying here. Let us know you're listening. And go to the website. You can go to paulsevangel.com or martinzender.com. Just let us know you're listening. We hope to see you on Monday.